The March 2021 crash of a Beechcraft Bonanza A36 in Pembroke Pines, Florida, resurfaced debate about the turnback, or the impossible turn, an engine-out course reversal shortly after takeoff to land in the opposite direction on the departing runway. Initial NTSB reports indicate the pilot of the Bonanza attempted a turnback with disastrous results. Opponents of the turnback argue that it's impossible in some aircraft and near impossible in the rest. Even with a glide ratio that makes the turnback technically possible, they say, the difficulty of the maneuver, close proximity to the ground, a startle factor, and the stress of life or death consequences all conspire against a successful outcome. Proponents argue that turnbacks are a viable option for some pilots in some aircraft under some circumstances. As for the FAA, they caution that CFIs should train single-engine pilots not to attempt a turnback unless altitude, best glide performance, and pilot skill allow for a safe return. In April, the AOPA Air Safety Institute flew test profiles in several aircraft to determine the feasibility of the so-called impossible turn. We flew turnback profiles at Martinsburg, West Virginia's 8,800-foot-long, 150-foot-wide runway. Our lineup included me in my 150-horsepower 1993 Piper PA-18 Super Cub with full gas. Editor-at-large Dave Hirschman flew solo in his van's RB4, fully fueled. AOPA Director of Flight Operations Luz Beatty, alone in a fully fueled 1978 Cessna 172 November. And Hirschman and AOPA Vice President of Flight Operations Dave Roy in a 1971 Beechcraft Bonanza A36 with a 300-horsepower Continental IO-550, full gas, and 40 pounds of baggage. Prior to the exercise, we all climbed to altitude and practiced stalls, including stalls in 45 degrees of bank, to calibrate the actual stall speeds at play during our turnback exercise. We then established our minimum required turnback altitudes using a technique inspired by airline pilot and CFI Brian Schiff. We set a climb profile, cut the power to idle, and began an idle power, 45-degree bank turn at best glide for 360 degrees, noting the altitude lost.
Lost 1,000 feet.
The idea behind using a 360-degree turn is that practicing at 180 degrees is not enough. The 180 degrees will get you turned around, but abeam the runway. In reality, it takes more turn to get back over to the runway and aligned with the runway centerline. With stall numbers and expected turnback altitude requirements freshly established, we each flew three profiles in near-perfect conditions. Cool, sunny morning, light winds, and low-density altitude on a simulated 4,000-foot-long runway. The plan was to climb between VX and VY with full power to the predetermined altitude, cut power to idle, delay 3 seconds to simulate a startle period, then push to best glide while entering a 45-degree bank turn back to the runway. I went first in the Super Cub.
All right, here we go. All right, let's climb out at 60. Really halfway between VX and VY. Go to 300 feet and try it. Engine failure. 1001, 1002, 1003. Now react. Push over, catch best glide.
The Super Cub returned to a simulated 4,000-foot-long runway in all three turnback attempts, one at 500 feet AGL and two at 300 feet AGL. In fact, I estimate I could have returned back to a 2,000-foot-long runway in the Super Cub. Next up, Dave Hirschman in his RV4. Hirschman initiated turnbacks at 1,000 feet AGL. Thank you.
900 for 1,000. Here comes 1,000. Okay, power back. 1,001, 1,002, 1,003.
He made it back, barely, 2 out of 3 times. The third time would have resulted in a landing short of the runway. Hirschman's performance may have been impacted by his 3-blade constant speed propeller that created far more drag at high RPM setting than a fixed pitch prop would. Luz Beatty made her turnbacks at 1,000 feet AGL, 800 feet AGL, and 600 feet AGL. She comfortably returned to the runway each time. Both Beatty and I may have benefited from some idle thrust with engines still running, but experts such as Catherine Cavagnaro advised us that the light thrust we might have received at idle power was somewhat offset by the drag from the moving propeller. So the advantages of an engine at idle are believed to be minimal. The last airplane to try the turnback profile was the Bonanza, and those results were perhaps the most startling.
Airspeed's alive. Okay, coming up on 1,000.
We now clear to re-enter the right downwind 426.
1, 2, 3. There's 100 knots.
And under 0 Sierra is beginning to run my turn back.
Stop. 0 Sierra wind.
Go ahead. 05,
runway 8, clear to land.
Clear to land, runway 8, under 0 Sierra.
No, that's not
doing we'll push it back
thing.
In.
Yep, you got it. And I'll get the gear.
Okay.
Let's hold it.
Just a second.
Yep.
Nowhere close.
No.
Absolutely nowhere close. Okay, get the gear down, please.
Turning back at 1,000 feet AGL and varying speeds from best glide 110 knots to 95 knots to reduce the turn radius and propeller settings from high to low RPM, Dave Roy and Hirschman didn't come close to making it back to the runway in any attempt.
This is nowhere close.
Yeah.
There's nothing that we could do here that's gonna bring it in.
Even in an optimum glide configuration with landing gear and flaps up, the Bonanza would have come down well short of a simulated 4,000-foot long runway. Our takeaway is that turning back is a viable option for certain aircraft in the right conditions, flown by proficient pilots who train for the maneuver. It's not a good option for aircraft with high climb speed and high best glide speed, as we learned with the Bonanza. These speeds combine to take you farther from the runway on departure and result in more offset in the turnback, leaving you longer distance to glide. Pilots flying aircraft with these characteristics should eliminate turnbacks as an option for engine failure after takeoff. Variables like wind, temperature, density altitude, runway length, and technique could affect these results, but not enough to change our overall recommendations. Please don't try to fly this exercise solo in an attempt to prove us wrong or confirm our results. We've lost pilots training in these maneuvers due to the high potential for an uncoordinated stall and spin in the turnback. Fly with a CFI, at altitude first, and determine your strategy in the event of an engine failure on takeoff.